Hi, I'm Jen Kramer. I'm a freelance instructor specializing in HTML and CSS, and this is Intermediate HTML and CSS. In this course, we're going to explore all kinds of HTML semantic elements that you may not be aware of. We'll be talking about CSS selectors, including some of the latest CSS selectors like is, where, and has. And we'll wrap up with the hard parts of CSS, including inheritance, specificity, and the cascade. So if you're ready to up your HTML and CSS game, let's get started with Intermediate HTML and CSS. We've covered ordered lists, we've covered unordered lists, we've covered a bunch of different kinds of selectors, the ones you're familiar with, grouping selectors, descendant selectors, attribute selectors, all the nth childs, and that sort of brings us up to a baseline here. Those are tend to be the things that people work with a lot inside of HTML and CSS. Going forward, now we get into some interesting wild and crazy stuff that we can also do with semantic HTML and with different kinds of styling. So the next thing we are going to explore are our description lists. You may also know these as definition lists. That's what they used to be called, definition lists. Now they're called description lists because they're not just for definitions anymore. So we are here in chapter 2, we're at part 3, and there is a link here to this demo code pen. So if you want to open that up, this is just going to go through how we would go about marking up a description list. So I've got my HTML up over here on the left-hand side. So the way you start a description list is with the DL tag for description list. And of course you end it with slash DL, as you probably could guess. But since this is the list that is for key value pairs, there are two list items that wind up here in the list. So DT is for the term, DD is for the description. So DT is the key, DD is the description. And those terms and descriptions can be organized as follows. So over here in the display side, you can see we could have a one-to-one relationship, one DT, one DD. We could have a one-to-many relationship, one DT, many DD. You can also have a many-to-one relationship, many different DTs with one DD, or we can have many-to-many, many DTs to many DDs. All of those are all absolutely legal in a description list. So here I have talked about various types of fruits and vegetables, and we are just pairing them up here so that we have all four of those types of key value pair possibilities are all represented there. Now, so that is just the raw styling for that particular kind of list. One of the things that would make this more useful is if we could group these elements, right, so that we can do interesting layouts. And we are limited in what we can do in that regard. One of the things that is legal is to use the div element to group each set of key value pairs. You can't just group, put that div anywhere you want in the description list. You have to put it around the relevant key value pairs. So we have, in this case, of course, fruit and apple, those go together. That's in a div. Vegetables, which are broccoli, spinach, and squash, that goes inside of a div, and so forth. Let's look at these description lists, and let's talk about interesting ways to lay them out. So what I'm starting with here is I have a portion of that list that we just talked about. So right now I just have a series of one-to-one relationships between the DT and the DD. What might be one thing that I could do to start to lay these out? Anybody have any ideas?
Give a border to the DTs?
We could give them a border, absolutely. Might we want to put these things side by side? Maybe a column of information? That would be kind of a fun thing to do. All right, so let's say that we're going to have a div. We're going to put a div around our fruit apple. And we'll put another div around our vegetables broccoli. Oops, slash div. And clean that up. Okay, So now what I have is I have divs that are grouping together those DD and DTs. So anytime you see that, in this case, this div is the parent, the DT and the DD are the children. Now we have a relationship between parents and children, and we can start to think about things like flexbox or grid, right? So let's start applying some of those. So what I'm going to say, we don't even actually even need a class in this particular situation for these divs. In real life, you might have a class on those divs for obvious reasons. But just for fun, let's just go with it here. So we'll have our div. We'll say display flex. We could say flex flow row wrap, right? So now we've got them at least on separate lines, true? If you can't see it, you can't style it. So let's take a look at our individual elements as well. We have a DT and we have a DD. Now that DD, as you saw previously, it's indented slightly. So there is a, I forget whether it's margin or padding that's put on it. I think it's margin. So if I said zero, yeah, it's a margin. So if we put a margin on that, we can get rid of that slight indent, right? Maybe what I want to do is set a max width on this div. Let's say like 400 pixels. And we can put a border on that, always. 1 pixel solid red, so we can see where the list is. Okay. And now for our children, for our DDs and our DTs, we could think about making these the same width. So one way we could do that, if you want to talk about funky selectors, we could say div star, just like this. All of the children of div, then we could say flex basis is 50%. So now they're of equal width, right? I'll give you a second there to catch up. So in summary, we've got a max width set on our list to only 400. We don't have a huge amount of stuff. We don't want it spilling all over the page. Clearly, you could apply responsive design here. We have a border going around each of our divs so that we can see where they are. We set that up to display as flexbox and in a row. So now we have our DT and our DD. They're next to each other. Then I've set all of the children of the divs, which would be all the DTs and all the DDs. We're just doing it in a very efficient sort of manner here. Right, we set that to be 50% wide. We could do anything else that we wanted here. We could say for the DT, we could say font weight bold, right? That would be something we could do. We could put a little bit of padding on these. Maybe we want to say padding on our divs. Maybe we want to do, oh, I don't know, 1 rem. Gives us a little bit of space around those. And if you wanted this to actually look pretty, we could say something like border bottom, 1 pixel solid, maybe a nice dark gray. Woo, poof, kind of nice looking, right? And then we have my last favorite trick here, which has to do with hats. And this just blew my mind when I saw this one. All right, so we're gonna deal with this list of animals here. Now, it would be really nice to be able to take these bullets that I have here and maybe make some columns out of them. Wouldn't that be great? And we could write flexbox to do this, or we could write columns to do that, but it would be even better if we could make this conditional. So in other words, if Iceland suddenly gains a whole bunch of animals, a whole bunch of new animals move to Iceland and this list gets longer, or a bunch of animals die off and this list gets shorter, we will be able to handle that inside of some kind of conditional code that will format accordingly. And so the way that we can do this is with the has selector. So has is this wild and crazy one that selects completely differently than everybody else. So as I have told you now a couple of times, we write our selectors left to right, but we read them from right to left. We go from deep in our HTML going outwards. Has goes the other direction. It's going to start from the parents and work down to the children. It looks for patterns on the parents and then applies, if that pattern in parentage works, or ancestry, I should be more specific, if that pattern of ancestry works, then it will apply styles to these specific children. And so the crazy thing that we can do with this has to do with that list layout. So I'm just going to add this down here to the bottom after everything else. What we can do is this. So for it's an unordered list, right? UL has. And what I'm going to say is for my li nth child, 6. In other words, we're testing to see if we have at least 6 children in this list. Because we just tested to see if the 6th one is there. If there are 6, let's make columns 2. Oh, sizzle, sizzle, right? So now it's smart enough to know that I have at least 6 things in that list. Why 6? I don't know. I just decided that was a good spot. And it's smart enough here, by the way, to make those relatively even. I think there are 15 of these, so one column has 8 and the other column has 7. All right? So we could apply even further styling. We just put it a little further down the page. So UL colon has LI colon nth child. Let's say the 11 of them. So if there's 11 of them, that may still look a little bit long. Then we can say columns 3. Wah. So it's smart enough to know that in my 15 item list, I do have an 11th child. So now we're going to set it up with 3 columns instead. And it doesn't apply to the seabirds where there were only 3 of those. So it doesn't fit either of those tests. It doesn't fit that there are 6 items. It doesn't fit that there are 11 items. So we have this, continue to have this stubborn problem with the separate style sheets where we have our standard style sheet of unlayered styles. We have layered styles inside of the ADME style sheet. Even if I were to do something like put all of these styles that are here inside of my style.css, put them in a layered style, we are still not going to be able to get that ADME style to come through as long as it's in a separate style sheet. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to copy the ADME CSS, just highlight all of it and copy. Make sure that that bang important is off of the color white that we had added at one point along the way. And I'm going to go scroll to the bottom of my standard style sheet here. And I'm going to put in at layer, ADME is going to still be the name. We'll put in the double brackets. And then I'll paste all of my styles inside of ADME. You'll notice that my errors here in VS Code are going to continue to add up. These are all related to layers. Once again, and VS Code doesn't know about them. That's why it's giving me all these errors. Okay, so now I have a layer inside of the style sheet called ADME. What about all of these styles that are unlayered? They are still going to trump anything inside of ADME, even though ADME comes later in this document, according to the cascade. So what I'm going to do instead, I'm going to get rid of this first line of code here with the at import. I don't need it anymore because I've just added those styles to the end of the document. And I'm going to put in an at layer, and I'm just going to call this standard. These are my standard styles. They're the ones that I started with. And I am going to wrap those curly brackets around all the styles that I had previously. So everything down to the layer of ADME. So I've flattened the cascade in a sense. We no longer have unlayered styles in this document. Everything is inside of a layer. We have a standard layer and we have an ADME layer. Right now, because the ADME styles come later, they are going to take priority, just like they would inside of CSS normally. And if we open this up in a default browser, you'll see that our text is white. So that is another possible solution. But We could also, what happens if, for example, there are other things in here that are conflicting with what we have in our standard style, and so we decide to put this add me style earlier in the document. So I put it before my standard styles, and I drop it here, and save again. What color is that text? The pink declaration is going to come later in the document, so this is going to show up pink again. All right, this is the last part of this. We can specify what layers we want to have in the order we want them evaluated. So now at the very top of the document, according to the spec, this is where you have to put it, we can say at layer, and then I can say standard, comma, add me, semicolon. So that is an indication to the browser to evaluate the standard styles first and the add me style second, even though add me is coming first in the document. And so now when we save this and we take a look at our web browser and we refresh our page, our style will be white again. So I've just showed you a whole bunch of different ways to solve these conflicts. Just to summarize once again, we have the use of bang important, which I don't like. We can copy over one of our layered styles into our unlayered style so that it takes effect. And there's probably downsides to that. The other possible solution is to include all of our styles in some kind of layer and then indicate the ordering of those layers. If we needed to, now I had only kept all of my add me styles together in a single layer, we could pull out that one style and give it its own layer name. And I'll show you that here just real quick. Let's just say that that color white is the thing that's driving us bananas. We could add, you know, a layer called difficult, because these are the styles that are being difficult for us. And we could then say, we just want figure A any link, and it's gonna have that color of white. So now it's broken out into its own special layer. We can then say that we want add me first, then we want our standard layer, and then we want our difficult layer. So we can sort these in whatever order you want. And if you want to put the difficult layer first before add me, you can totally do that too. This is the order that in which they will be evaluated. So now when I save my style sheet again, and I take a look at this inside of my web browser, my text is still white. And that's because I have pulled out that white color into its own layer, and I have the cascade set up so that that is coming last in my document in a functional sort of way.